Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Anatomy of Knitting, episode 83. My name is Erin. I'm going to be your host. Today is October 22nd, 2015, and I'm coming to you from Cork, Ireland. I'm an American expat living here, and you'll see my co-host Ari here, and then I have another co-host over there. That's Lola. And so this week, I'll have a week in review, or weeks in review, because I took last week off, and so what's on the needles, and some sewing stuff. So let's get started. So first things first, you're probably wondering what I'm wearing. This is my gnarled oak cardigan. I'm going to just button the top button so you can see it briefly. You can kind of see it. It's a little dark in here. That's really overcast outside, and I have both overhead lights on in attempt to get things to show up, but unfortunately they're not showing up super great. This is my gnarled oak cardigan. This is a design by Alana Dacos of the Never Not Knitting podcast. This is from her, I believe it's her first book, Botanical Knits, or no, it's Coastal Knits, my apologies. That came out, gosh, I think like 3 or 4 years ago, that book did. I cast this on using String Theory hand-dyed yarn in the Black Cherry colorway, and I used US 6 needles. And I finished it back in January of 2012. So, let's see, what else can I say? I use the Knit More Girls Couture button band tutorial. I found this gorgeous ribbon that goes perfectly with the yarn. And then, let me see if I can show you the buttons a little bit better. I found these at the Button Emporium down in Portland, Oregon. They're the oak leaves with a little acorn, and it's just a really comfortable sweater, and things are getting cooler here, and I've been wearing a lot more hand knits. I've been wearing this sweater out and about in public. I've been wearing my Shalom cardigan in the house because it's not of a very flattering style. I knit it when I was pregnant with the boys because I thought it was that style of sweater is it makes me, like, normally look pregnant, and I figured the only time it'll look very flattering is when I'm actually pregnant, so that's when I knit it. Unfortunately, when you are gestating two little humans, you tend to get very warm very often. All of our metabolisms. So unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to wear it all that much when I was pregnant, but it used up some yarn that I had had in my stash forever, and so I've been wearing those two mainly, and then I wore my Dunedin vest, I think it was Monday or Tuesday or so. Must have been Tuesday. It was when I took the boys to their new toddler group, so yep, this is my gnarled oak. I love it. I think it fits really well, so... And it's a fairly flattering color on me. It's a little, it's not as bright red as what you see in your screen. It's a little more, it's a little darker. So, not quite as vibrant. So, our week in review. The last time I podcasted with you, I had, it was the day before I was going to take my driver's test. And I'm happy to report that I passed my driver's test. And the reason I didn't podcast last week was because I went downtown and actually applied for the driver's license. The way the things are here is that you take your driver test in one location and then you have to go and apply at a separate location. So I took care of that last week, and I had planned on podcasting, but by the time that I finished that and it had done some running around downtown, by the time I came back, it was like 11-ish in the morning, and I like to get my podcasting done early, so, yeah. I didn't podcast. I worked on some sewing and some, I think what I did last week was I caught up on Project Runway. I've been watching the U.S. Project. Well, there's no Project Runway anywhere other but than the United States. So, yeah, I've been keeping on top of this season's Project Runway, which is exciting. Let's see what else we can review. The boys and I found a new toddler group to go to. We had been going to the one that's at the Family Resource Center here in the village, but it just never really felt like a good fit. The boys could have taken or left it, and I don't know. It just seemed like more for younger kids. So I'm a part of the Ballincollig parent and child group on Facebook, which is a closed group. What? And look at little Ari kind of talking to me. And so they have a list of all of these activities for kids and parents and toddlers. And one of the ones is a toddler group run by the gymnastics center here in the village. So I thought that sounds kind of interesting. I bet the boys would like doing that. And I know that they have classes for 3-year-olds. Which the boys aren't quite 3 yet, but I figured, hey, this is a way to kind of get them exposed to the gym and kind of see how they like it, and if they like it, maybe we'll do some classes. So the boys love it. Like, I took them last Tuesday, so not 2 days ago Tuesday, but last week's Tuesday, and they have been talking about it ever since. Like, they wake up in the morning and they turn to me and they go, are we going to go to toddler group today? Can we go to toddler group? Sadly, when they ran it last year the last school year, they had it on Mondays and Wednesdays. But now they have it on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So the boys miss out on it one day a week because they're in school. So I wish it was still on Mondays and Wednesdays. let's see. They have this long trampoline, which I think they probably use to help people learn how to do the vault. That's my only guess is what it is. And it's a long runway that you can run down, and the boys love to run down it and run back. And there's foam mats on the other side, and so they run down to one side and then they run back and jump on the foam. And then they ask me to do it. And of course I have to do it. I have to get on the trampoline and run and jump and all that stuff. So, they had the, uneven bars, which the boys were able to hang from the lower one and act like monkeys. They like doing that. They have, one of those little toddler slides that they can go down, and they really enjoy doing that. Nathaniel especially really enjoyed doing that. I'm trying to think if there's any other pieces of equipment that we played on. They have a big trampoline that the boys got to get on last time, but they weren't using it properly, so I didn't allow them on it this week. But they keep talking about toddler groups, so we're going to keep going. Sadly, Monday is a bank holiday this week, and I guess it's midterms at school, so we won't have a toddler group this coming Tuesday. We'll have to go, I guess, it wouldn't be the week of Halloween. Would it be the week of Halloween? No, there's no toddler group on the week of Halloween. It would be, I guess, the first Tuesday in November? Yep. We'll have to go back the first Tuesday in November, so. Let's see, what else? We also took the boys to their first, structured class this past, Saturday. I don't know how I found out about it. I think it must have been on Facebook or something, but there's an organization that I believe started in the UK, called Rugby Tots, and it's basically rugby classes for kids. And when I say rugby, I don't mean like they're tackling each other kind of thing. It's they're learning the basics of the game right now. So when I signed up for the class, gosh, I want to say back in August or maybe even July. It was a while ago, and put it in our calendar, and sadly, I didn't put in the appropriate reminders, and we missed the first class because we had forgotten that it was, I thought it had started this past weekend when it had started on the 11th. So we went this past weekend on the 18th, and it's a fairly structured class. What they do is it's just physical activities. They play this one game called Jungle, where you have to pretend like you're an airplane. And then when somebody says the magic word, you crash, and then you kind of figure out where you are in the jungle and what kind of animals you see. So it started out that Nathaniel, it was a little overwhelming for Nathaniel, but by the end he was really enjoying himself. Malcolm did really well for the first class. It's held in a sports center, and where we were in the sports center was on the tennis courts, and it's kind of echoey and cement-y. So if you can kind of imagine the kind of noise, the how sound is reflected in that. So they had fun, and they learned how to score a try, which is a rugby ball is very similar to an American football, where it's kind of shaped like that. More like if I could do an even. Yeah, I guess it's shaped like that. So it's pointy up at the top and at the bottom, and then there's laces. And what you do is you have to squash the worm, squash the laces down on the ground to score a try. And they also learned how to kick to see if they could score a goal. And that was fun. my husband and I found it was sort of how, it wasn't that the boys got a lot of, I mean, they did get a lot of physical activity, but the parts where, there were parts where we had to like hold them back. They wanted the kids to do each of their turns one at a time. Especially for like the kicking part, and holding them back from doing that, like keeping them from actually doing what they were supposed to, not at their specified time, was hard. What else? There was an obstacle course that they set up at the end that Nathaniel did really well at, which was surprising. That was one of the things that, you know, you can't have 12 toddlers going at once through an obstacle course. You have to kind of let them go one by one, and holding Nathaniel back from doing that was a challenge. But once he did, there were like five poles that he had to weave through. And then there was, a bar that he had to jump over. There were hoops that he had to run through hoops on the ground. And then, it's one of those like ladder things where you're not supposed to touch the rungs. And then there's another bar. And a lot of kids, so they wanted the kids to hold the rugby ball while they did this. But unfortunately, a lot of kids couldn't. But Nathaniel could, which was really surprising, because he's not, out of the two boys that I have, Malcolm's the more physical one, and I thought Malcolm would be more able to do that.
Excuse me.
What else? Rugby tots. So that was fun, and we'll go back again on Sunday? Yeah, it's Sunday. And they have three more, it's a 5-week class session, and they'll have three more sessions. And I think the other thing that happened this week that you could probably see, which I just about forgot to tell you about, was that I had the little basal cell carcinoma removed here. And I had those kind of bumpy things removed. it's the mirror. Yeah, so I have owies, as Malcolm likes to say. And yeah, that was an adventure. I'm not very impressed with the facility that I went to. It's a little run down. And my So the way healthcare works here is that you get sent an appointment time. You don't actually have any say-so, or at least much say-so in your appointment time. And so my appointment was at 10:30 on the 16th. And I went in and I spoke to the receptionist and got all checked in. And then they said, okay, sit down and we'll call you when you're ready. So I sat down and I sat and I sat and I kept And I got out my knitting a few times, and I would knit a couple of rows, and then I'd be like, okay, well, they're calling all these other people. They're going to be calling me soon. I ended up sitting there for an hour and a half until finally I got up and said, is it common to be sitting here an hour and a half? Because I've seen people who came after me not only get taken in to the day surgery center, but they're leaving because they're done, and this just doesn't seem right. And so apparently what happened was the person who was doing the reception area went on break, and the person covering her is who I spoke to, and the person who was on break came back as I was finishing up, and nobody actually took my chart to the back. So the doctor thought I was a no-show, even though I had been sitting out there. I was early. I was 15 minutes early, and so I was angry and, you know, really frustrated, and I feel like the doctor did a rush job because had I not said anything, he would have been going home, and I would have had to come back another day because of no fault of my own. So I had a fair amount of bleeding. You can see, you can still kind of see there's a crusty little blood clot there that's kind of stuck to a suture that I haven't been able to dislodge yet. But I did get the rest of it off, thankfully. There's a little line there, and you can't really see the sutures. Let me see if I get. Yeah, you can kind of. See that little fishing line right there? It's kind of a clear suture. So yeah, and then there's the. They kind of burned those things off, which was lovely, let me tell you. So now I just have to heal, and I was able to take my bandages off a couple of days ago, and now I just have to wait to heal, and then I think there's another week, and then I get the stitches out there. So yeah, I think that's all the highlights of things that have happened. Let's get on to the knitting. First thing I'm going to show you is not all that much. Knitting wise, you'll remember these are some socks that I have been working on out of some vintage Sweet Georgia Yarns stash in the blue fig colorway. This is her superwash sock. And here is my one completed sock. I've had this complete for a while now, I think I'll say. It's got purples, and then some magenta, and then some blue as well. And I just like the way that kind of pools. And I'm doing my typical stockinette stitch sock, where I do about an inch of ribbing, maybe about a 4 or 5 inch cuff, my slip stitch heel, my regular heel turn, stockinette foot, and then just a regular wedge toe. So I wound the second ball, and I've just about a cuff complete. And you'll see that there are a couple of ends here because there was a fault in the yarn. There wasn't quite a knot, but it was like two plies had, or, you know, one ply had been damaged, and, you know, they felted it together. Not Sweet Georgia, I think whoever supplied her yarn did that. So I just preferred to take it out. So it's messed up my little color pooling repeat, but thankfully there's only like five rows where the original pooling happened, and then now the pooling's changed a little bit. So I probably have another four rounds to go on the cuff, and then the ribbing, and then I can start on the cuff. I'm kind of trying to do these when the boys go outside, if they let me. There's a swing set in our backyard, but the boys aren't quite capable of pulling themselves up to the seats and they haven't learned how to swing themselves, so basically I have to push them. But they hold on really well. But it's fun for them. So that's that. Hopefully I'll have the ribbing done and some of the cuff knit next week. The next thing I have is my acorn trail. That's what it's going to look like on the front. And then it's got that cable panel in the back as well. This is an Amy Herzog design. You can buy the acorn trail as a pattern with predetermined measurements. But what I decided to do was do the custom fit recipe. And somehow my pages got wet. I think I had a soda in the car or something, and the condensation did this. So this is my custom fit recipe acorn trail. And what you do, if you're interested in doing one of her custom fit recipes, is that you buy the recipe first, and it tells you what you need to put in to get a custom fit sweater. So basically you're following two patterns at once. You use the preferences that she tells you to put in to set this one up, and basically it's things like sleeve length and neck treatment and what else? Button band width and if you want it high hip, low hip, or medium hip, and the fit. So it's stuff like that. Basically little tweaks that you're going to want to do to the design. So you get a big it's not very pretty. This is the custom fit recipe. It's just basically text. And you basically have to read both sections at once. So I'm currently on the left front. And so basically it says cast on X number of stitches and work twisted rib, and you just kind of have to read both parts of the sections at the same time. I've had some issues where I've had to rip back for the previous pieces that I have. But things are going pretty well now. Let me get not one, but two completed sleeves. You'll notice that the last thing that I was working on was the sleeve. So I finished that sleeve, and I did a fair amount of knitting on it at the doctor's office while I was waiting. So there are my two sleeves. Haven't blocked them yet. I need to take them upstairs, especially the these ones. Like, sleeves, I can live without blocking. Because I knit the sleeves. I didn't follow the recipe. I didn't follow the directions. And I knit the sleeves in the round instead of flat. Because I hate seaming sleeves. And I don't really think your sleeve needs the structure of a seam down here to give it stability. I know you need seams up here sometimes just to give the sweater stability. So, yeah. This is the right front. Yep, looks like I got some thread on it. And it's got the razor shell lace right here, and then the seed stitch cable, seed stitch, what do they call it? Seed wishbone cable is what it's called. I always forget the name of that. So there's the right front, and here is the back. It's got two of those seed wishbone cables, the razor shell lace, and then in the center, it's got a reverse wheat ear cable, which to me kind of looks like a spine. That's what it reminds me of. So I think I'll take these upstairs today and block the front and the back so I can, once I finish with this, the left front, I can assemble. I started this, if you give me a moment, project. This is the Acorn Trail. I started this September 9th. So I've been about a month and a half in. I think I'm doing pretty well. And I'm using, don't think I have a button band here. I do not. Oh! Old boy knocked it on the ground. This is Blarney Woolen Mills Donegal Tweed Hand Knitting Wool, made in Donegal, Ireland. There's the yarn info. Suggested US 8 needles. And it's about 183 yards. I think I'm using US 7s to get the gauge that I'm getting. It's my swatch that I did. And it's the yarn changes a little bit with washing. It gets softer, most definitely. And it's a singles yarn. And there's some veg matter that I've had to go in and pick out. I'm currently working on the waisty creases. And yeah, so that's all I have done of the right, left front. it took me a few repeats to get the cables memorized. But now I have everything memorized. I don't need to refer to the chart anymore, thankfully. And yeah, I'm cooking with gas. So those are the things that I'm knitting on. This is all that I have left of the, let's see, I haven't been keeping track of how many balls I've used. I know I have 12, I had started with 12 skeins, and the skeins are in the ottoman that you're sitting on. So I will report back how much yarn I've used probably next week. Oh, crazy hair. All right. Yeah. So those are all the things I've been working on knitting-wise. I've kind of been thinking, you know, once you get kind of close to the end of a sweater project, you kind of think, okay, well, what am I going to do next? And I've been thinking that the thing I'm going to knit next is from a kit that I have upstairs. It's a kit that I purchased, a fair amount of time ago. And I believe I purchased it from Jameson, and it's going to be a hat. The sheep hide hat. I think it's hide. H-E-I-D. Let's see. Let me just confirm. It's sheep head or hide or... Yeah, H-E-I-D. And it's designed by Kate Davies. And it used Jameson and Smith Shetland Supreme jumper weight. And it's ham with some sheep around the brim, horned rams atop the crown, and it uses 9 shades of the Jameson yarn. And I purchased the kit, it was before the boys were born, and so I figured I would start that project. Because I kind of, again, it's getting chilly, and I kind of think I need a nice fun hat that won't get stolen by a little boy, because that's what happened to my Furju. It is not my hat anymore. It is Nathaniel's hat. So I think that's going to be my next project. We'll see. Sewing wise, I have a little over a week to finish all of our Halloween costumes. I am doing fairly well. I think I will finish on time, knock on wood. My outfit is completely done. I finally bit the bullet and brought my, so I have 2 sewing machines. I have one that I use as a travel machine that I take with me when I go to my quilting classes on Monday. Where was I going with this? So I normally keep it like on the second floor, so it's easier to take, to the classes, and it's out of the way of the boys. So I finally took it upstairs because the travel machine is the one that can do zigzags and other decorative stitches. And so I took that upstairs and I overcast the edge of the hem so I could finish the hem. And then I sewed the hem. So the hem is all complete. My dress is complete. My crown and what's the word? Amulet. That's what I'm saying. Amulets were sent. They were 3D printed and painted, and should be on their way to me right now. So my costume is done. The boys' costumes, so I made the Mario and Luigi hats, and I'm going to show you the, I'm going to insert the pictures here. Those were really easy to make. They look a lot more complicated than they actually are. What I did was I took a dinner plate and I doubled the layer of my fleece because they use fleece to make their hats. I traced the shape of the dinner plate and I cut that circle out. And then on the edge of the fabric that I hadn't cut, you know, the still intact fabric, I took the dinner plate and the instructions that I used suggested that you overlap. I think that's the best kind of term I can use to make so you're going to make a brim. So from that curve that you use, or that curve that you got when you cut out your circles, you put the same dinner plate about 3 inches above that cut curved edge, and then you cut that part out. You sew that little wedge together. I got an itch. And flip it right side out, and that makes the brim. With the double layers of the hats, what you do is you cut a circle out of one of them, so it kind of makes a donut. And before you sew those two together, you make the little M or L that you need. And I just used a white piece of fleece and then drew out the letter that I needed on the fleece, and then cut those out and applicate the letter onto the white, and then the white onto the donut of fleece. Once your letter is appliqued on, you then sew the dinner plate circle to the donut circle and flip that right sides out. And then I found the center of the brim, and I put the center of the brim where the appliqued letter was. And then I just kind of sewed from edge brim to edge brim. And that's basically how you make a Mario and Luigi hat. For some reason, I had convinced myself that it was going to be a lot more complicated. But, excuse me. I have the red fleece here, and then my mom sent me some green fleece in the mail that I wasn't able to find here. And, so I think doing both of the hats took me an hour and a half, and it would have been faster. I could have done it faster. I just was kind of slow. I did that, and then I figured out, so the tutorial I used for their Mario and Luigi costumes were, I'm going to say it's on the blog Smashed Peas and Carrots. And basically she suggests that you take a pair of pants, you trace around the pants about with the seam allowance that you want, and then that's your pattern. That's how you make the pants. And that's what I did. I drafted my own pants pattern and made some overalls. They still need need some big yellow buttons. I haven't procured those yet, but I think I can do those next week. And then I just have to do hems for the pants and make sure that the bibs of the overalls aren't too big. But that requires the boys to try them on, and they haven't been very cooperative with me. Cause I don't think they remember dressing up last year. Well, obviously they don't remember dressing up last year and getting candy, but I'm trying to tell them, okay, this is what we're doing. You know, we're going to go get candy, but we have to dress up to do it. So, I've got a week to do the last little bit of finishing on theirs. So that's good. And then, my husband still is, I have the most work to do for him. I have to sew the toenails onto his booties, to give him 3 claws on each foot. I have to hand sew all of the stuff onto his hood, and I have to make his shell. Still, I think I have I have a fair amount of... I think I'll make it, is basically what I'm trying to say. yeah. I think that's it. I think that's everything. I will be including pictures at the end here of the boys, because they're super cute. And, yeah. I think that's it. I want to take the time out and say thank you. I know hearing me ask you to go to Craftsy is kind of, you know, nobody likes to really hear ads, do they? No, they don't. However, I did get, I did get a payment, from Craftsy, from those of you who have gone to the website and have clicked on my ad and, purchased your Craftsy class that way. It has been able to pay for 2 months of hosting fees. So that's amazing. And I just want to say thank you. Because I'm not doing this podcast to make money. I'm not gonna get rich off of this podcast. I just kind of want it to pay for itself. So if you're interested in taking a Craftsy class, if you could please take a moment to go to my website. There should be a banner on that side. it should be a knitting banner to take knitting classes. Just click on that. Craftsy is able to track where people come from, how people get to the website, and how they purchase classes. And if you do that, they give me a little bit of money for thanks to give them advertising space on my website. And no more extra money out of your pocket. You're spending money that you were going to spend anyway. And so it's no extra money on your part. And I basically just want the podcast to pay for itself because I'm not earning money anymore working. So I have to kind of find a way for the podcast to pay for itself. So yeah, I think that's it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It was really exciting because I honestly never, like I've said, go to Craftsy and please do this, but I've never actually thought anybody would do it. So it was really nice to get that. So yeah, thank you. Thank you. Okay. I should be podcasting next week unless there is a absolute emergency and I have to use the entire day to work on costumes. I don't think that'll be the case. My husband's going out with some friends tomorrow for a work thing. And so I'm going to sit here, I'm going to catch up with more Project Runway, and I'm going to hand sew his hood, I think, and his claws onto his feet. So I will basically have the turtle shell to do next week. I think I'll be okay. We'll see. thank you for watching, and I'll see you next week, unless things happen and I'm not able to. Yeah. And enjoy the pictures of the boys, and let me know if you have any questions by posting on the Revelry group. Okay, thanks so much for watching. Bye.
Where are you going to take me?
I can take you to the Grammy's house.
To Grammy's house?
Yeah.
Yeah? Do you love Grammy?
I give kisses.
You give hugs and kisses.
To Grammy.
To Grammy. What about Pa and Uncle Dustin? Do Pa and Uncle Dustin get hugs and kisses?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I just have fun.
Yeah.
Grammy's.
Yeah.
Cheese. I'm looking for complication. Looking 'cause I'm tired of trying. Make my way.